Good evening, I'm Christian Esguerra, and welcome to this episode of After the Fact, where we get to see things more clearly, where we get a better sense of the truth. Let's begin by dissecting the news. Vice President Lenny Robredo is running for president in 2022, ending months of hopeful anticipation among supporters who believe the Philippines can no longer endure and does not deserve 6 more years of a Duterte-like governance. The other goal, of course, is to defeat the son of the late dictator Ferdinand Marcos, who is also gunning for president. In a speech before she filed her certificate of candidacy, Robredo made it clear her will is strong to take up the challenge. She also asked supporters to go out of their comfort zones, reach out, take a stand, and take action. Now comes the important part. How does she win? How does she overcome perceived advantages of other candidates in terms of support base, political machinery, and of course, money? Now be part of our discussion. Send us your questions and comments on our YouTube live chat or tweet us using the hashtag ANCAfterTheFact. Joining us tonight is Senatorial Aspirant Attorney Jose Manuel Cheldocno. Good evening, sir, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Good evening, Christian, and good evening, everyone. Thank you for having me.
Okay, it was no secret that from the very start, you were rooting for Vice President Lenny Robredo to run for president. I suppose there's a heave of relief now on your part that just made it official.
Yes, I'm elated, actually.
Okay. Now, in our last conversation last week, you mentioned something about your optimism about what would happen in 2022. Now, based on the reactions to the announcement of the Vice President, was that actually reinforced?
Yes, definitely. I was overwhelmed by the positive reactions we saw online, especially, and even on the streets. And that has really inspired me even more. It's very energizing.
Okay, but what makes you hopeful now that despite this initial support coming from different sectors, especially as reflected in social media, that somehow that the Vice President could pull it off? Because number one, of course, if you go by the results of the pre-election surveys, she's still lagging behind other candidates. And of course, there are perceived advantages of the other contenders.
Well, the Vice President has a very inclusive personality and approach. It's the type of politics that I think can get a lot of people on board. And that's exactly what the opposition needs. It's not divisive at all. And she can attract those who are, let's say, undecided, those who are not sure who they will support in 2022.
But do you think the Filipino electorate is ready to embrace this kind of politics that she has been trying to espouse? Because this is definitely very much different from the kind of politics that they embraced, at least 16 million of them, in 2016.
I believe we are ready for that. I believe that people have experienced the other type, and many more of them now don't like it. We have seen how that has managed to transform into a lot of abuse and a lot of issues of corruption, and I don't think the people like that.
Okay, earlier I think you were in a meeting with the Vice President, right? Were you among the first who actually got confirmation from the Vice President, or just like most of us, you just learned it after she made the announcement?
Well, we all waited with bated breath for her to make her announcement at 11 this morning. And it was really only then that I was able to say, to breathe a sigh of relief, actually.
Okay, and you are running under her slate, right?
Well, yes, she is pushing, and I truly support this, a united opposition slate, meaning that although we belong to different parties and she's running as an independent, I think she has the pull to get everyone on board who is opposing this administration.
But with her declaration that she's running for president and the filing of her COC, does it mean that for all intents and purposes, that at least the basic kind of unification that many people are looking at is actually over?
I'm sorry?
Because everyone has made their decision, all those contenders that the Vice President was talking with before she made her declaration. They had also filed their COCs. So does it mean that somehow the unification efforts are over?
I don't think so. There's still a period of substitution, for one. And second, when we speak of, as I mentioned, I think when we spoke last time, when we speak of opposition, it's really a very malleable concept. There are politicians who were not clearly part of the opposition a few years ago, but who became very anti-administration within the last few months. So it's such a malleable concept. It's really hard to get your head around it.
So what kind of unification can still be expected from here on?
Well, first, I think you have to look at it from several levels. If you're thinking about the voting public, then they're not really allied or organized under the different political parties. So that is an open arena for any candidate to really attract them into their camp. If you're speaking of the organized political parties, of course, they have their own people on the ground, and whoever has filed their certificates of candidacy, they will be supporting. So we have to look at it from those different layers of elections.
Does that form of unification, will that also be reflected, for instance, more concretely in the senatorial slate that the vice president is trying to put up?
I believe so.
And how?
Well, I really can't say much and give you many details about the slate because that hasn't been announced yet. But I think it will really be an effort to broaden the coalition.
But is the plan to put up all 12 candidates?
As far as I know, yes, that's the plan.
Okay. Yeah. Was this also tackled this afternoon when you had this meeting with the vice president, with other personalities from the opposition, including those who are actually running for senator as well?
Well, it really wasn't a meeting per se. It was more a meet and greet where we were finally able to see the vice president and hear from her, you know, what she had announced earlier that day. But the real meetings, I think, are going to come in the weeks to come.
Okay. In your case, you ran in 2019, and of course, that was a result that you didn't want. And you're running again in 2022. What do you think would be the difference this time? For example, in terms of preparation, in terms of the lineup, in terms of the slate?
I think it's going to be very, very different. In the first place, we have much more freedom on the ground. We will not face the same obstacles we faced in 2019. You know, it was a midterm election, and there are even the space itself to meet people online, of course, more than on face to face. Is there's so much? Let's just say the air is much fresher now, to use an analogy.
Mm-hmm. And what do you think of your chances? Because at that time, there was a lot of hope as well from the part of your supporters, including the supporters of the Ocho Derecho slate in general, right? But we knew the result. Basically, the slate was wiped out.
Oh, definitely. I will be the first to admit that. But, you know, we knew also that we were facing not just an uphill battle, but a really big mountain of a climb in 2019. I don't sense that as much this time around, possibly also because I've been around once already. So it's not something that's new this time around.
But what are you going to do differently this time?
Almost everything, I would say, even in terms of how we will approach the messaging, how we will come out, especially on the social media platforms, because a lot of the campaign, I believe, due to the COVID-19, it's going to be done online.
Okay. Let's talk about the narratives or the plots that are involved so far in the campaign, although the actual campaign period hasn't started. So far, much of the conversation is dominated by the anti-Marcos sentiment, the goal to defeat the Marcos candidate in 2022 and to prevent Duterte's candidate from also winning. Is this, from a tactical point of view, somehow is this a good approach as far as the opposition is concerned? Or that you should focus on other important issues to be able to court more voters?
Well, I'm not sure that is really the thrust of the conversation now. Although, when you look at the news media, that is part of how they're projecting it. I think that we have to be forward-looking if we want to have a very successful campaign. And we must be able to address the problems that every Filipino is facing on a daily basis from the moment they wake up until the time they go to bed. These are issues that really affect everyone. We're talking, for example, about education for the youth. We're talking about the economy. We're talking about how we're going to help those who've lost their jobs and the MSMEs, the businesses that have had to close or are really on the verge of closing. We need to do something immediately to help them. And I think they're going to look at that also when they decide who they will vote for in 2022.
But what difference in terms of articulating the messaging would be made this time in 2022? Because I remember during the 2019 campaign, there were political analysts who were criticizing the Ocho Derecho approach, including your approach, because the allegation or the perception at that time was that much of the campaign of the opposition was directed toward criticizing the incumbent, the sitting president. And then you were also criticized for, I don't know whether this is fair or not, of focusing on the criticism and not providing alternative. So learning from that, how would you do it this time?
Well, I think with this time, number one, we have to emphasize the shared values of all Filipinos. Number two, we must demonstrate the dissonance with what is happening today and then provide hope for the future. Because that is what I believe the voting public is really looking for. And that's really what we all want. You know, I do agree that criticizing the government on its own is not going to bring much votes. It will probably capture the camp that is already supporting the opposition, but it's not going to widen the voting base. What will widen the voting base is if we can capture their imagination, make them understand that we all share the same values and that we all want the same thing to happen in our country. In terms of concrete measures, you know, in terms of how we will deal with the daily life of every Filipino. Tingin ko, yun talaga yung hinahanap nila.
Okay, example, did the issue of extrajudicial killings, human rights violations under the Duterte administration, you're very much passionate about this, of course. This is part of your life's work. But learning from the experience in 2019, how would you do it differently to be able to capture the imagination of the voters and make them care more about this issue?
Well, while I am personally deeply disturbed by what's happening when it comes to the extrajudicial killings, especially, and the human rights situation in general, I don't think it will be top of mind for many of the voters. And that means that candidates like myself will probably have to adjust our messaging when it comes to that.
You yourself are going to shift somehow?
No, I mean, those are principles that are deeply embedded in me, and I will continue to push those for those issues. But if you're talking about how a campaign should be messaged, how the communications strategy should be devised, I don't think that will be one of the top issues that we can push.
Okay, I remember also when President Duterte won, a lot of analysts were saying that the decente or the decent politics approach espoused by the previous administration, as shown by the results in the 2016 elections, proved to be not working, right? So in this case, we're also, especially after the announcement made by Vice President Leon Robredo, we're also seeing a return to that kind of narrative. To be able to separate the opposition or at least Vice President Leon Robredo from the Duterte narrative or the Marcos narrative. But they think the experiences over the past 5 years somehow were able to convince the voters that somehow, even if this was rejected in the 2016 elections, it's also time to embrace it again.
You know, my own analysis of our political history would seem to indicate that we have cycles of for example, during the Marcos dictatorship, of extreme authoritarianism, extreme repression in terms of human rights and even issues of corruption, and then you have in between periods where there would be more open and democratic space, and we returned in the last administration, I mean the present administration, to a really more autocratic type of leadership. And that tends to wear very thin with the public that has not felt any benefits from it, especially when we have a pandemic and you have a public that is awaiting, really expecting from the government a lot more than they have gotten, I believe, from this government.
And do you think the Vice President is in the best position to actually articulate the kind of politics that you are talking about?
I think so. I really like what she said this morning about ang nagmamahal ay kailangan ipaglaban ng minamahal. I think that strikes to the core of what Filipino values are all about.
Did you also somehow feel the influx of volunteers or support after this announcement was made? Because I remember you mentioned before that in your case, there are a lot of volunteers who were coming in. But did you also somehow notice it this time?
Well, it's too early. It's not even been a day. But I think we are, the energy at least that I sense is very, very nice, very positive, and very strong.
Now, when it comes to the senatorial slate that is being formed now, you said you're not yet at liberty to talk about this, right? But for sure, you're running under the slate, right? And the others are Senator Leila De Lima, Senator Risa Ontiveros, Senator Antonio Trillanes, who also filed the COC, no? In terms of the ability to win or to get seats in the Senate by this current pool of contenders that you're forming, how is that different compared to the one that you had in 2019?
Well, in the first place, I believe what will be fielded will be a full slate of 12 candidates. And that will be a distinct advantage in the sense that each of these candidates will have their own pool, their own supporters, their own political machinery. That in itself is going to broaden the coalition. And unlike in 2019, where the eight who ran for the opposition, most of us were actually newbies who had not much support on the ground, no networks. This is going to be, I think, a much more seasoned approach to the elections.
The one that you had in 2019, was that somehow hastily assembled for the 2019 elections?
I'm not sure what hasty would mean, but I would say that at least for myself, you know, I came into the picture quite late, and we hit the ground having to catch up a lot in 2019. At least now I've had the luxury of time to really think about it, plan, and expand the network.
Okay. And what do you think of the choice of vice presidential candidate by presidential candidate Lenny Robredo? So the choice is Senator Francis Pangilinan. What advantage or value added would he bring to the table for that particular ticket?
I think that will be a big advantage for the vice president to have Sente Pangilinan as her VP, because iba rin naman ang dala niyang suporta, especially since he would, I think, have a what you would call a different sectoral type of support from what Ma'am would have.
Which is?
Ma'am, VP Lenny really has a much support in the grassroots, especially in terms of her work with the Laylayan Coalition. That to me is will bring her much support, especially in this area. But when it comes to Kiko, I think he's also got some pull with the youth. He's got some pull also with other sectors that are not necessarily within the domain of VP Robredo.
Do you think this time the vice president would still be saddled by the negative propaganda thrown against the yellows or the so-called Dilawans back in 2016 and of course in 2019? You also felt that when you were running for senator then, right? But do you think that could still be a factor in this presidential run by the vice president?
Tingin ko, it will not be as big a factor as it was in the previous election. While definitely those who are for the administration are going to keep on hammering at that, that's to be expected on their part. But you see, the elections will not really be determined by them. It will be determined by those who haven't yet made a firm decision on who they will vote for. And that's going to be the essence of victory in 2022. Who will be able to really capture their imagination and get them to say, I want to vote for this candidate. it's not, to me, going to be a question too much of where the brand that is given to them by the opposing side, na dilawan sila, but it's going to be what can the candidates do for them given the hardships they're facing today?
Definitely, results should be provided. And of course, alternatives should also be given. I remember also during the discussion in 2016, there were analysts who were saying that one big advantage of the president at that time, presidential candidate Rodrigo Duterte, was his authenticity. Parang kung ano naisip niya, sinasabi niya. No? Then that was also thrown against the candidates of the opposition in 2019. Yung sinasabi, puro kayo disidesente, pero ano ba kayo, di ba? But do you think that particular tactic can still work in 2022 now that the slate is led by the vice president, the authenticity card?
Well, there's a lot of lessons to be learned from 2019. And I think that we have spent the last 2 years really trying to figure out what didn't work and what can work in 2022. Personally, I really can't speak for the other candidates, but to me, we need to embrace who we are, and we need to really be able to project our authenticity. And that's going to be the key in terms of getting support from the electorate.
Okay, Attorney Jose Manuel Chiel Diocno, thank you very much for joining us tonight, sir.
Thank you, Christian. Good evening.
We're going to take a quick break. After the fact, we'll be right back.